Roses and Bones. Francesca Block. Psyche in a dress. Psyche. I am not a goddess. I am my father's. My father had me mutilated twice. He had my mother and sisters murdered more than once. But he has never killed me off. Sometimes I think he only gave me a life, so I could be his muse, his actress. They say he does things with me, to work through issues he had with my mother. I look just like her in the early films, but now she is gone. In the first film, I had to take off my top. I stood there, shivering, with my hands covering my breasts, as the cameras were rolling. A million caterpillars crawled over my bones, and my stomach was filled with the wings of dying moths. But I knew what I had to do. I am an actress. I am my father's. I do my job. It was easier after that. I got used to all the crew watching, my father watching. People said that I was odd-looking, not the typical face you see, but my father tells me I am perfect. Just what he wants. My father says, these actors, they try to do so much. You know how to just be. Don't try to do anything else. You are an actress, my princess. I live with my father in a dirty white mansion made of the bones and teeth of actors. It has been the scene of many atrocities in my father's films. There are crumbling columns in front, and a dining room we never use, with a giant chandelier from which one of my father's characters hung herself. There's a huge tiled pool, surrounded by crumbling, headless, limbless statues, thick as trees entwined with morning glories, beds of calla lilies and oleander bushes. I can see the pool from my window, empty. My father rarely fills it with water. It was used for a drowning in another film. I have a large room, with a large bed draped in diaphanous fabrics. I have my own bathroom with a sunken tub and a view, through glass windows, of my private, somewhat overgrown rose garden. Peeling white iron chairs and mossy fountains. I have a walk-in closet of my mother's designer clothes. In one interview I read, my mother said that she sold her soul for that wardrobe. A black satin-trimmed smoking jacket and trousers, a white satin-trimmed smoking jacket and matching satin skirt, and a gold pleated chiffon Grecian gown, a golden sweater covered with gemstones, a white silk wrap dress covered with giant peonies, a pink suit with a short jacket and skirt, shift dresses in white, black, red, sapphire, emerald, and tangerine silk or satin, some with large bows and back, piles of cashmere sweaters and lipstick colors, some with silk flowers from Obi's appliqued on them, and many, many shoes. When my mother left us, she took only a black suit, a pair of jeans, a red silk blouse, her jewels, and 5 pairs of the shoes. Sometimes I lie awake at night, wondering how she chose them. I knew which ones they were, because I knew her wardrobe better than she did. Black leather riding boots, black lizard pumps, strappy golden sandals, ruby red flats, emerald green satin dancing shoes with ankle straps. I was so jealous of those shoes. Sometimes I put on one of the dresses, light candles, and dance with my mother's shadow. Most of the time, at night, I only use candles in my room, waiting for her to come back. Even a wraith is better than nothing, even a silhouette on the wall. My father's new girlfriend, Aphrodite, wanted to be the star of his film, and he wouldn't replace me. Once, I heard him saying to her, she's 17, what do you expect? Enraging her even more. They screamed at each other all night, until the chandelier shattered, and 1,000 swallows flew through the open window, whirring their wings. In the she was not finished. One night, I was lying in my bed, wearing an antique cotton nightgown, white as a bride. My father was out drinking with his producer. It was completely dark. Not even the candles were lit. I could have been abandoned on a mountaintop. The wind in my chest was that cold. That was when you came, through the open window, with the night-blooming jasmine that grows up the old stone garden wall. You knelt beside my bed and put your head near mine. You whispered, "I just want to lie beside you tonight. I won't hurt you." I was afraid at first, lay very still, waiting for pain. It felt like a scene from one of my father's movies, the killer with the beautiful voice. For a moment I wondered if my father had staged the whole thing, if he had a camera somewhere. I wouldn't put it past him. "You only talked to me," you said. "Tell me." You asked, "Do you think love and soul are the same? If not, how does the soul earn love? How does love find his soul? Can one exist without the other? If love and the soul had a child, what would her name be?" "Tell me your name," I said. "You already know. If you are soul, I am the other one." I heard the sea in your voice, sheer waves breaking on pale powdered sand. I heard the glossy rustlings of the cypress and olive trees, the footsteps of mayonnaise and panpipes playing, echoing caves in the mountains, cloven hooves striking the rock. At their approach, birds took flight into the white skies. After a long time, I fell asleep. In the morning, you were gone. But you came, again and again. I asked to see you, but you said that was the one rule. I couldn't put on the light. Even so, I asked you to lie beside me. After a while, I reached out and held your hand. "I'm so crazy," I said. "What's wrong with me? You come through my window at night. I haven't seen your face. And I want you." Even in darkness, your lips taste of sunshine. They leave a slight stinging spray upon my lips. Your skin melts over me. I feel you enter like a shaft of light. My bones dissolve around. We become liquid, eternal. I am released from my mortality. You wiped my body with a cool towel. I told you what my father shot today. You said, if you were my daughter, I would just sit you in front of a camera and let it watch your face for hours, every expression. He cut off my mother's head, I said. He made it keep talking. She had to have a mask made of her face, plaster and bandages. She is claustrophobic, and she said she almost died, breathing through those little straws. You held me in your arms and pressed your lips against my hair. After a long time, you whispered, "The wild girls cut off Orpheus's head. He shouldn't have looked behind him. His music could have brought Eurydice back from the dead." "But he didn't hear her footsteps," I said. "You can't doubt your gifts." "Maybe he didn't doubt himself. Maybe he doubted her. His love for her." You were quiet, thinking. "My father doesn't doubt," I said. "What about you?" I shook my head. Doubt tastes like sand in the mouth. Philomela was raped, and her tongue cut out so she wouldn't tell. She turned into a nightingale and sang her story. You told me all the myths, one after the other, night after night, my beautiful, brutal bedtime tales. As you spoke, I closed my eyes and saw them come to life, the miniature figures acting out their parts. When we fell asleep, my dreams were more vivid than they had ever been, as if I were watching your dreams in my head. The man who got to be a flower with 100 petals admiring himself in a pool forever, while the girl who loved him was only a voice, unable to even choose her words. the girl who crashed through the earth in a chariot drawn by black steeds, punished for just one red pomegranate seed, unable to choose where she lived, a queen only in darkness, a princess, her mother's daughter, weaker in the light. Love's mother, the jealous one, who sent his beloved on a quest, carrying her heart in her hands like a broken urn. Love, the shining god with wings. Love, the monster. I love you, I said. Please, let me see you. And you said, you can't doubt so much, Psyche. But my sisters were wearing black dresses and big sunglasses. Their skin was tan. They came to visit me. I heard their heels click wickedly on the marble floor. Tell us about this lover of yours. There isn't anybody. Bullshit, my older sister said. Your skin never looked so good. They wouldn't stop asking. I've never seen him, I told them finally. What? They were appalled. He only comes at night. You've never seen his face. He smells like night blooming flowers, crushed juicy petals on the pillows. His voice is full of ocean, humming like the surf. He kneels before me like I am his goddess. He is a god. They laughed at me. Then their faces turned grave. You must make him show himself, they said. He may be a monster. Why did I listen to them? They have long white blonde hair, large breasts, and brown skin, like their mother. I have my mother's black hair, blue eyes, and pale skin, full features and large hands like my father. My breasts are small with large areolas, my legs long and too thin. I know there is something odd in the way my knees touch and my neck strains. I am not sure why you chose me. Maybe you are a monster. One night, you came to me. I hid in the shadows and waited. Saw a dark figure go to the bed, feel around for the shape of my body. Your movements became more agitated when you did not find me. You called my name, lay down on the sheets and searched for my scent. Moved restlessly for a while, like a baby or an animal, and then became very still. I crept over to you and lit the candle. It was a tall tapper that smelled of melting honey. In the light, my lover was revealed. His beauty monstrous? If so, then my sisters were right. His beauty was so sharp it could have cut out my heart. He lay naked, sleeping on my bed. How could it be? Why had he chosen me? I wanted to run and hide from him. As I stood amazed, a drop of wax fell from the candle and touched his bare shoulder. He cried out and leapt up, his face filled with pain. I told you not to look at me, he said. My mother was right. No girl wants to hear those words. He was so bright, a conflagration, and I had seen too much. I had seen the god. I was not. I dropped to my knees and covered my eyes. Don't come back here, I said. Why do you doubt me so much, Psyche? He went to touch my shoulder, but I pulled away. And then he was gone. My room has never been so empty. There is only one monster here. She is ready to do anything to be forgiven. She has been mutilated, on film, but still. Her mother has been murdered more than once. Now the monster's mother is just gone. What more must Monster Girl do to find the god again?